Mahler finished his massive Seventh Symphony in 1905, and when it was premiered 3 years later, it was the finale, the fifth movement, that caused the most controversy. It somehow didn't seem to fit with the rest of the work. And when asked about it, Mahler rather cryptically replied, "Was kostet die Welt?" Literally, "What the world costs," which can be interpreted in many ways. So we'll look at the music and its composer and the world around him and see what he might have meant. A new century dawns, and a world superpower undergoes a fundamental transformation. Sound familiar? Well, in this case, it's the Habsburg Empire in Vienna, the cultural center of the world in the early 20th century. And the author Stefan Zweig wrote, "It was not the military, nor political, nor the commercial that interested the people. The first glance of the average Viennese into his morning paper was not the events in Parliament or world affairs, but the arts. And something of the extravagance, the pretense, the artifice of the arts was deeply ingrained in the nation's culture. But this transformation, the radical changes, scientific, political, sociological, and artistic, were developing with amazing, dizzying speed, and Gustav Mahler, director of the prestigious Vienna Court Opera, was right there in the middle of it." And to what degree was Mahler attuned to these startling changes? Was Vienna the city of wine, women, and song to him, or of neuroses, decadence, and despair, or perhaps both? At the turn of the 20th century, as we know, Mahler entered a new phase of composition, beginning with his Fifth Symphony, much more abstract and technically advanced than the first four. But in the Seventh Symphony, he seemed to revert somewhat back to his old folk-inspired romanticism. So after four movements of dark, mysterious, sometimes terrifying beauty, the finale of the Seventh Symphony begins in a blaze of glory and sunshine. And everybody said, "Ah, Mahler is sweeping away the shadows of the night." Mahler himself said, "Was kostet die Welt?" And how will he create happy sunshine music now, since he's somewhat caught between two worlds, the old world past and the progressive present in which he must survive as an artist? Thus, we are faced with the most unusual and confusing music that Mahler produced. The finale is a huge expanded rondo, a traditional form, where we hear the main material, the A material, return again and again, but it's always separated, it always alternates with other new episodes, B and the C material and what. And Mahler's tempo marking here is bizarre, allegro ordinario, that is, lively in the usual tempo for celebratory music like this. So already there seems to be a bit of cynicism at work here. And fanfares, brilliant ceremonial fanfares, starting in the low timpani? Timpani, yes. Wow. And this in the strings. This dotted rhythm, bup, 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 and a descending pattern. And these two things, the dotted rhythm and the descending pattern, are present in most of the finale's themes. And now our principal theme, our A material fanfare. Well, this is the basis for all traditional tonal music, the tonic and the dominant pitches. It's often in the bass. We'll call this the timpani motive. And the fanfare continues in the brass. And this soaring, descending scale is harmonized like so. There. That major seventh chord, there's something special about it. There's a certain flavor. The very first time I heard this music, I think I was 17 years old, and I heard this chord. To me, I said, it has a slight tinge of sadness to it, doesn't it? Maybe it's just me. Now, the second part of this theme is, I suppose, the famous quote from Wagner's Die Meistersinger, you know, beginning with the tonic dominant thing and continuing Wagner's celebration of romanticism and old world tradition in German art. And Mahler writes, same beginning, and it continues with this progression. There's something very emotional about that, don't you think? And it's followed by this. This sort of ceremonial descending that's so familiar in music, whether it's in military mode or in joyous Christmas carols. It certainly is triumphant here. But isn't there, seems to be a bit of, just a bit of sadness, some regret in Mahler's use of it. Just a little. I think there is. Our next theme, then, is another good one. It's also built on a descending pattern, but it's robust with the timpani figure in the bass. The theme is now extended with the dotted rhythm figure, like so. With bagpipe figures in the oboes. All merrily marching along in what sounds like a festive banner-waving procession. And this theme suggests so many things to so many commentators. Some say, well, that's Franz Lehár's Merry Widow, Act Two, isn't it? And other people say, well, no, that didn't premiere till after Mahler had composed this symphony. Others say, well, that's from a popular operetta from 1899 or something. Others even point to a theme from an Italian opera from 1904. Mahler's theme is this. And the Italian theme is this. Qui verran. It's pretty close, I would say. That's Act One of Puccini's Madame Butterfly, where Goro describes the procession of Butterfly's family that will attend her wedding, Puccini writing in a faux Japanese idiom. And Mahler certainly knew of this opera when he wrote his Seventh Symphony. It had a dismal premiere, but then a huge success in early 1904. Or how about a very popular English operetta, also on a Japanese subject? To sit in solemn silence in a dull, dark dock with a presidential prison with a lifelong lock. Very similar. Who knows what this theme represented for Mahler, if anything. But there is a definite resemblance to these other themes with exotic associations. I will call this the Puccini theme. Why not? Well, this whole opening C major theme group, our A material, reaches a delirious high point, complete with jubilant winds and violins over the fanfare, which is abruptly cut short by an A flat major triad in the woodwinds. Out of nowhere, it dies away, and our B group of themes begins with this. With delicate flute trills. But this tune, now wait, maybe that's Lehár's Merry Widow, huh? I don't know, it could be, who knows. We are led into a lovely, graceful promenade, this B material. I call it a promenade, has that character. Again, it's very unchallenging, old-fashioned music. Then, as expected, a reappearance of the A fanfare, like in any good rondo, yes. We launch then into a new section, the C material in a new tempo and meter, but it is the Puccini theme in a new version. The believe me, this finale has come under scathing criticism because of the incessantly jolly music it contains. Now we hear another variant of the Puccini theme. It's in the woodwinds. Descend. This will soon become a lovely minuet. But not before the promenade, the B returns in the minor key. And we have a dotted rhythm marching tune. Rather grim, the bass drum being played with a wooden brush called a ruta, used in traditional Turkish music. And Mahler now constructs this rondo finale, as you will see, in big block-like sections. It's very easy to follow. You have the A material, the fanfares, then B, and you say, well, here's A. Oh, of course, that's as I expected. Now we go to C. A comes back. It's almost like he's exaggerating the textbook rondo form for his own amusement. And the counterpoint, the very intricate interaction of inner voices in the texture, this is all hyped also. He's obviously paying homage to the past masters that Mahler, that he studied and admired. Here, as an example, a hearty rustic folk dance combined with Baroque-like counterpoint, and the bagpipes are in the violins. And then the minuet, which to me is the key to the true nature of this movement. It's in A major. I think this is the rondo's D material, and it's played by a string quintet, just as it would have been in the Royal Chamber Hall of the Habsburg Palace. And the minuet also contains a prominent descending pattern in the melody. It is this. With this, yod, and then again higher, yod. This is sort of an Austrian yodel. It's very charming. People are always citing the parodistic nature of this movement, but, you know, to some degree maybe. But does this sound like a parody to you? So lovely. It is really, sincerely lovely music. But now a new figure blasts its way in. Actually, it's not new. It's the timpani figure, now rather crude in the trombones, and the Puccini theme in a raucous, combative mode. Bare octaves in the strings, with a pounding bass drum, rather brutish. Plunges us in to a raucous development section with fanfares and marches, even the minuet all jumbled together in a wild, near chaotic frenzy, out of which emerges the B promenade material, which now repeats. It breezes along, then without warning, a stately A fanfare in the brass, with the tam-tam, the gong, and giant bells ringing to add to the festive sounds. More warlike Turkish music, like the Janissary music in Mozart's Seraglio opera, which again hurtles us ahead, almost out of control, with a stunning cymbal crash and a downward rushing scale in the full orchestra, which you'll hear in just a moment. And now, the passage where I think Mahler's true intentions in this finale come through. Things up until this point do indeed seem chaotic, almost tossed together, this mishmash of styles and musical gestures. And out of this berserk orchestral tempest comes this in the brass. But that's our delicate minuet. It's as if it's caught in this frenzy of fanfares. The Puccini motive is rushing around it until, through an ingenious transition, the music sort of catches itself. It's like, wait, slow down, relax, relax. You're the minuet. You're the gentle, you're the calm element in this finale. And there's a lovely cadence in the brass. The genteel trill. Here is this stunning transition. And now that order has been restored, the minuet may proceed in C major in its former courtly Rococo character. Yayappa, yayappa. Those beautiful little yodeling figures with the gentle flowing Puccini theme underneath. And Mahler adds a kleinen Piston, a little Baroque trumpet, to the orchestra here to really make the old world connection. Here is this lovely and very important passage in the finale, the minuet, with the Puccini theme. This, it's continually interwoven as counterpoint. And little yodels. Yada-da-yappa. And listen to Mahler's expansion of this little motive later. And then higher. It is truly, truly magical, if handled with care. There, the former warlike march, bam, bam, ba, 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 ba. It's now a warm and sunny rose-colored vision of the past. Is this Mahler's cynical parody in the finale? I don't know. But not this section. There's whimsy to it, I'm sure. But I'm also sure that it's totally sincere, the sadness, the affection, the wistfulness of the music. You can't miss it. Now, big bells begin to ring out. The music darkens. The main theme of the first movement returns, very stern, bold. And from this point on, the music becomes more episodic. And just when it seems about to lose focus, the A fanfares from the beginning return for the last time, and in the final grand peroration, the first movement theme has been converted, rehabilitated into C major, showered with pealing chimes and the clatter of cowbells, which were used back in the second movement for a distant ethereal effect. Now it's like, forget all that, just bring the cowbells on stage and join in the fun. And again, call me crazy, but the very first time that I heard this passage, I sensed a sadness in it, or a sense of regret, and it's like something passing by. I don't know. There was a brief riotous coda, which is cut short. It stopped dead in its tracks. And you remember way back in the opening, the festive C major, diddle-diddle-dee, stuff with the fanfares, cut short by that woodwind chord, the A-flat major triad. And now, with only 3 seconds left to go in the symphony, the same thing happens, almost. But it's not an A-flat major triad. It's an A-flat augmented triad. Halfway between the keys of C major, which we're in, and A flat major, which we heard before, caught, as it were, between the two keys. Now, this chord is heard in the full brass with, and for a moment the music teeters. The facade is about to crack before the final big C major. And everybody knows this work now, and we can't wait for that final chord so we can start bravoing. And it is very, very exciting. That's fine. But what is it about? What just happened there? A couple of questions. Why did Mahler bring back the first movement theme to darken the final moments of the symphony? A theme which is very, very similar to the first movement theme of his Sixth Symphony. The tragic symphony. Why this tension, ominous, with the tolling of bells so close to the end of the Seventh Symphony? And why did that deliriously happy, why was it cut off? Why did it almost collapse there near the end, 3 seconds away from the end? And why was Mahler so far out of his groove in this finale? He was an incredible genius. If he wanted to write a sunshine driving away the night kind of thing, he certainly could have done it without resorting to this patching together all these archaic musical styles in such an obviously glitzy way. Why risk lowering the public's estimation of the entire work by selling out in the finale? Well, was kostet die Welt? Maybe what it means is something like the price you must pay. Think of this finale, a pageant, a cavalcade, a collage of fanfares and marches and folk dances, courtly dances, a melting pot, which could only be done in something of a parodistic way, I guess. But why? What was Mahler saying? What drove him to do this? In the few precious months that he had every summer to create these monumental symphonies, why waste any time, why waste a single minute of that precious time writing something so unworthy of everything else that he had written? And he knew this when he wrote it. He had to. Was kostet die Welt? Maybe what he meant was, this is what the world extracts from an artist. This is the burden, the duty of an artist to posterity, to parody the world, to portray it as I see it. The ridicule that I will endure for writing this music is what it costs me. It's the price that a true artist must pay for being truthful. It's just a guess, an informed one, because I want to go back now to my opening and what was happening in the world in Vienna in 1905 when Mahler created this work, the profound transformation of society in which he found himself. So here is some real-world context to consider when reevaluating this finale. I have 7 points here. Number one, Mahler was 45 years old when he finished this symphony. The youthful, dreamy idealism of his past was long gone. Number two, Mahler, as obsessively driven, self-absorbed, and neurotic as ever, continued to doubt his own worth as a composer, all of which hastened the deterioration of his marriage with his younger wife, Alma. Number three, in 1857, Emperor Franz Joseph ordered the destruction of the ancient walls surrounding Vienna. The result was a massive influx of non-Viennese immigrants, possibly represented by the ethnic styles just parading through this finale. Could be. In any case, most of these immigrants did not assimilate into Viennese society, and a great sense of cultural and ethnic unrest resulted. Number four, largely due to the influx of intellectuals, Vienna became the hotbed of cultural progressivism in the world. In 1900, Sigmund Freud's landmark Interpretation of Dreams revolutionized the way society saw itself. Before long, all of the arts changed radically. Schoenberg's school of composition, the secessionist painters, and an increasingly wide rift developed between Vienna's young radicals and the old world traditionalists. And where did Mahler see himself fitting in? At age 45. Number five, largely due to the influx of non-assimilating immigrants, racial tensions in Vienna soared. The opposing socialist political parties increased their disruption of society, which further destabilized the emperor's hold on power. Anti-Semitism surged. A young Adolf Hitler lived in Vienna beginning in 1908, an ideal breeding ground, perhaps, for his developing ideology. Number six, Mahler's reign as director of the Vienna Court Opera was becoming increasingly controversial as the anti-Semitic press, fueled by the political and social climate, ramped up its slanderous campaigns against him. And number seven, perhaps the most important, the militaristic rise of Prussia and the German states greatly altered the balance of power in Europe as the Austro-Hungarian Empire, under the rule of its aging, doddering emperor, surrendered its dominance as the superpower of the age. Now Austria, in defeatist mode, became more aggressive with the smaller countries like Serbia, for instance, where Austria's presence would ignite a world war in 1914, which then led to the dismantling of the Austrian Empire. The progressivism of the age, having undermined and contributed significantly to the downfall of a world superpower, there is a lesson to be learned. And most of Viennese society, as we've seen, seemed more concerned with who was singing at the opera on stage that night than with any of this. Clearly, the Viennese Empire, that bastion of power and opulence, was crumbling when Mahler wrote his Seventh Symphony. And since Mahler's music always embodies, to some degree, his own moral, philosophical, emotional worldviews, it would seem that the finale of the Seventh Symphony may have been the final opportunity for Mahler to revel in Europe's rich romantic past, to salute the old world glories of the Viennese Empire, and to bid them a fond and final farewell.